Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for iOS Today is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
Apps from Australian developers.
Oh, how exciting. Plus, we're going to get cooking fever.
And I also have a way for dumb people like myself to manage their money.
I have a way for dumb people not to die. It's all coming up next on iOS Today. iOS Today is brought to you by Rocket Mortgage by Quicken Loans. When it comes to the big decision of choosing a mortgage lender, work with one that has your best interest in mind. Use Rocket Mortgage for a transparent, trustworthy home loan process that's completely online at quickenloans.com/iOS today. Welcome to iOS Today. Leo Laporte here.
I am Megan Morrone. Thank you for having me.
And while you may not know it, the studio is filled. I'm going to do a little test. We're just going to see. There, I have an Aussie detection mechanism to see if there's any Australians.
Aussie dar.
Let's try it. We'll just see. Aussie. Oh, my God. It's full of them. They're full of the places, full of them. Visiting us from St. Norbert's School in Perth, Australia. It's a STEM group. They're studying science and technology and math, and it's great to have you guys. Mm-hmm. We even made this, that's the teacher in the back there? Yeah, how many teachers are with these? How many kids are there and how many teachers are there?
28 kids and 3 teachers.
That's not enough. You've been to Disney World in Orlando. They went to the
Space Camp
in Huntsville. You've been all over. Where are you going in Silicon Valley? Anywhere fun? Here.
Here.
Yeah. You going to go to Facebook or Google or Apple or any of those places?
No. No. This one.
That would all be a letdown after this,
yeah.
I think.
No, that's right.
I mean, we are one of the United States wonders of technology, iOS Today.
I think you're absolutely right.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
We're actually, in honor of our visitors, we're going to do all Australian apps today.
Yeah. Developers from Australia, future developers here in the studio, I hope. Now we wanted to inspire you. My favorite Australian app is Pocket Casts. That's an app that I use to listen to podcasts. I've said many times on the show I don't like Apple's podcast app.
I use Pocket Casts too.
You do?
And one of the things I like about Pocket Casts, it works on Apple, iOS, and Android, mm-hmm. and I can have a subscription, and then the podcasts I subscribe to propagate to both platforms. So I always have my podcasts mm-hmm. wherever I am.
Yeah, so you can do playlists, starred playlists. You can create your own episode filter. You can decide, what I really like is whether, maybe you're trying to, this works on your iPhone or your Android phone, so maybe you want to stream or you want to download, depending on whether space is more important to you or using up all your data is more important. You can choose the playback method, so stream by default. You can also change how much you skip forward or skip back in case you wanted to do that. So I just love this app. I've tried so many of them and it's my favorite. It also does, I also like Overcast, which is not an Australian app, but that one doesn't do video. So this one does video podcasts as well as audio podcasts. So here, it's pretty obvious how you work it. I have this problem. I'll start podcasts and then I won't finish them, and then I'll forget about them. So I always star ones that I really like, that I'm enjoying, and then it just goes into a little playlist with all the stars. So that's what I do, Pocket Cast, so you can just star it, and pretty easy.
Did you know that, we're going to pepper the show with Australia facts.
Oh, good.
Did you know that Melbourne almost was Batman Australia?
I did not know that.
Did you guys know that? Yeah, they knew that. They're taught
Why?
Properly. Well, there was a guy named Batman.
John Batman.
Well, I would have called it Batman. The question is whether Batman would have been called Batman if there had been a town in Australia called Batman. He might have been Melbourne Man.
Mm-hmm. Or then, for gender equality, maybe it was Batwomen or Bat People.
You
bat
always
people?
Have to bring that gender thing
I
up.
Do. Don't
you? So in Melbourne, they had a problem because these people are from Perth, so I could say this. People in Melbourne are not too bright, right? They walk in front of trains a lot. So in 2012, the Melbourne Train Authority said, Melbourne Metro, we need to make a public awareness campaign that says, don't walk in front of trains. And they created a video and a great song called Dumb Ways to Die, and a video game called Dumb Ways to Die that has now transcended Trainz. It's transcended Melbourne. It is a phenomenon. That is a classic Australian game. Dumb Ways to Die 2 here, and we'll play it. And it's really a fun game. So I'm going to get out of the settings here. Should we do, I don't know. What should we do? Drown Town or Freezerville? Let's do
Don't go in the freezer.
Yeah.
Don't lock yourself in the freezer.
Shall we play? Let's play. So the tap to avoid the cracks. So there's cracks in the... Almost went in. So the idea is you have a...
That was dumb.
You have a timer. You have a timer. And the idea is to I got the penguin. I won. That's good. I survived. Complete the jump. Trace the arrows. Holy cow. Whoa. Let's see if I can do that. Some of these are easier than others. Some of them don't lick the pole. Oh, come on.
You don't die from licking the pole.
I'm going to lick the pole. Oh, I had to lick the pole. I had to. So close the windows and doors because it's windy out. Oh, whew. So these are... This is actually, kids love this game. It's a fun game to play. We sing in the car. Oh, I didn't get rid. I'm dead.
Oh, looks painful.
Now this is an ad, so I'm gonna get rid of that. Guild Raid. I don't want to.
I noticed when you played the song, everyone in the studio knew all.
They knew
words.
It, didn't they?
It's part of their
childhood. Should we play the song? You want it? This is the original "Dumb Ways to Die." They've done a number of these, but let me find the video. Of the original Dumb Ways to Die here. Let's see. No. It's kind of fun, isn't it?
Are they jelly beans?
What are they? Jelly bellies, right?
Well, some of them weren't shaped like jelly beans.
You can build a bean. Make your own bean, right? So there's, I think there's four of these. There's two I see on iOS. I want to play the video. I would have thought they'd have the video on here. Let's turn that off. Back to menu. I guess not. Well, we can go to YouTube and play it. But Dumb Ways to Die, highly recommended. You know, I'll give you one more. I'm not going to make it a pick because everybody knows this game. But did you know Half Brick, the creators of Fruit Ninja, is an Australian company?
I didn't know that.
Of the great iOS games, and one of the reasons it was such a success is because it's made, really, I think, made for the iPad because it's just a... Oh, you have to swipe it. It's just a natural because you only need a finger and... And you slice up watermelon, right? Or other kinds of fruit. Should we just play one round in case you haven't played this? Because I just want to play it, that's all. Are you guys really good at this game by now? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, they're bored with this. Actually, I asked what a good game was, and I have a recommendation from one of the students here, Ayushi, right? Who says, am I saying your name right? Yeah, now I've killed the fruit. I've messed the fruit, and I'm lost the game. Ayushi says she's got a game, and I'm gonna show you that as my app cap. Mm. Anyway, a couple of very famous. These may be maybe the best known Australian games of all time.
Yes. Well, I have another app from an Australian developer, Procreate.
Oh, I love that.
This is one of the iPad's best art apps. You can see I've used it to draw this beautiful portrait of you, Leo, that I have here on my screen. I'm still working on it a little bit, but there it is. I use Procreate to draw that. It looks just
like me.
You. Let me draw that in there. Okay, so if you are an artist, if you love working with layers, this is a great app for you. Let's go back. I did not draw this. This came with it. But this is what someone with an artistic background could draw with
wow,
it.
Wow, that's really good. You know what I love about Procreate is you can actually watch them draw.
Mm-hmm.
There's a playback feature that lets you actually start with a white piece of paper. And if you're an artist, recording how you draw is really, really great. And this works great with a pencil. Right?
You can also live stream your drawing. I'm not going to do that because I'm not an artist. But with iOS 10, it integrates with live streaming, some like Twitch and some other live streaming apps. So if you are an artist, you can live stream. You can also do picture-in-picture, different brushes, different. You can make any colors. I'll just see if I can add to this a little bit.
That's so much better. Yeah. Wow. I wonder why I didn't give him purple hair in the first place.
Yeah. And of course, you can erase. Now it looks more like you.
Empty-headed.
There we go.
Airhead. A cloud of white upon his dome.
So Procreate is $6.99. You can also get Pocket Procreate for your iPhone. That's $2.99. If you are an artist, if you draw better than I do, I don't know.
In one way, you have a disadvantage on the iPad Pro because there's so many good drawing programs. It's hard to know which one to use. I think Procreate's a very good one to start with.
Yeah, definitely. If you are an artist, so Australian developers, you could be the next developer.
Should we do a, should it be sing along time now?
Yes.
Let's play the sing along. I forgot that you had to succeed in a few levels before you could get this video. So I quickly played a few levels so I could get the... This was...
Don't do that.
Dumb ways to die. So many dumb ways to die. They all know it. Dumb ways to die. But I bet you they know it more from the game than from the public relations campaign.
Well, the song came out like 4 years ago, didn't it come out?
Yeah, so this campaign was 2012.
Reminds you of your young youth.
Your young youth. When you were young youth. And you know, I bet none of these people have done any of these things since.
No. So it's, they would have if success. They had not watched this video, I'm sure, especially the piranha bait part.
When Michael was probably 10, we would sing this in the car all the time. So this really did pervade the national attention. It's probably driving people crazy, so I'm going to stop it right now.
All right, do you have any more? Because I have a couple more.
I'm out.
Okay, I'm not out. If you are not an artist and you want to pretend like you are, there's an app called Canva, also an Australian developer. This is really for graphic design. So you can, I made this. iOS today, only on Twit. Super easy. You can use all of these layouts. They're all built in there. Pancakes. But say you want to change that to Leo, you can.
Well, of course you do. Oops. You know, I was a little disappointed. The whole crew from Perth went to lunch before the show. I was hoping they'd go to International House of Pancakes. Because they probably have, you know, an Australian pancake. It's international. But no, they went to Mexican food.
So have you seen Canva? What do you think?
Canva?
Mm-hmm. This
Canva,
is Canva
is also from Australia.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Another great choice. Mm-hmm. See, this is what I mean. You really, Canva's fantastic.
It is.
I think it does many of the same things Procreate does. I don't know. Is Canva maybe, Canva's more designed to modify a photo.
Yeah.
So it's more for editing an existing image than for creating an image from scratch.
Yes, it's more graphic design, would you say? More branding.
Yeah.
So you can make posts for Instagram or Facebook, blog entries. It's really pretty easy to do. So yeah, social media presentation. If you want to update your Facebook cover page, that's pretty easy to do. You know, that thing that goes banner image in your Facebook. I don't know. Do you guys use Facebook? That's not a high school thing, is it? You do? Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Snapchat and Facebook.
You know, I lied when I said I was out because one thing that happens to me all the time when I'm really in the mood for a Bunting snag, I want to hop the Perth Transit and ride on over to Bunnings and get one.
Bunnings, not Buntings.
Buntings.
Bunnings.
Oh, well, no wonder I never get there. Let me just use Bunnings. This Perth Transit app to see how I can get to the nearest Bunnings and get myself a Bunnings. You know,
snag.
I give up.
Bunnings snag.
Bunnings snag. Bunnings snag.
How do you get there?
I don't know. It says on Perth Transit. Apparently, Perth Transit has done something bad to me. They've looked at my location and they've said there are no buses near you.
No Bunnings snag for you. If you want to take a train, you need to use another app created by an Australian developer, Trainz Simulator. Trainz with a Z.
Oh, Anyone use Trainz Simulator? This is really fun. Yeah, I like this.
This is Trainz Simulator 2.
Right.
This is complicated. I spent a lot of time this weekend, you know, hard work. And hopefully I can figure out what to do. Let's go back to the main menu. Let's just go ahead and learn to drive. Which train do you want to learn to drive?
I want to drive the Trans-Australian Railway.
I don't know
what that is. The straightest line in the world. There's absolutely nothing to do. You just go. There's no steering, no stopping. You just go.
Now, this is $6.99, which is worth it. It's a really great train simulator. You can do easy mode or realistic mode. I'm going to try easy mode. With the steam trains, you can actually control how much coal is going in there and everything.
You know, there are a lot of train games made in Australia. I think People really love trains in Australia. That's why. Yeah.
You think? People love trains everywhere.
Of course, Australia is massive. And, of course, our students are from the West Coast. And that's a long ride to get to the East Coast through a lot of nothing. So a train is, right? So a train, you stop at Ayers Rock and you're done. So a train is best way to get there.
Yeah, this is not Australia.
Burlington, this is America. It's America.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Burlington Northern.
You can do multiplayer, so you can chat with people.
Can you toot the whistle? Oh, I love that.
Yes, I can. Somewhere.
You should never drive a train.
I shouldn't drive a train. Never. That's true. What? Yeah. I thought I was learning.
You're nothing. You're not learning a thing.
Back to game.
What is this? Train Simulator.
Train Simulator 2. Okay, let's get started. There we go. Now I can drive the train. Uh-huh. If you go too fast, it will penalize you because you don't want to slip off there. You may need to change junctions ahead. Okay, I'll change junctions. And there we go. If you like trains, this is interesting. If you don't like trains, this is like someone showing you their model train set and you're watching and you're bored. But I like trains.
And this is the one with a Z, not an S.
Yes,
train.
A Z, exactly.
Trains.
I'm speeding. I don't care. I speed. Life is short. Sometimes you have to speed your train.
Not really. You know, this always amazed me that people like train simulators because not really all you can do is stop and go.
No, this is the easy mode. Oh. I told you with a steam train.
You don't have to steer with a train. They've got rails.
That's true. That's why people like trains, I think.
It's an easy.
You like staying on the track. You don't, but I think I died. So.
How could you die?
You run off the rails.
You went too fast for that
curve.
Like
this show is going that way.
Always.
Let's
every
not.
Okay,
I think I have more. I'm sure there are even more.
Oh, man. Australia's full of great ad developers.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Peter Moore is one of our viewers.
Speaking
he recommends
of Moore.
SBS On Demand. Do you know what SBS is? I think that must be, that's the TV. Do you guys ever use SBS On Demand? That's some, Peter,
do you guys
say
ever
sometimes.
Watch TV at all? They watch YouTube, I bet, mostly, right? Mostly YouTube? Little TV?
Yeah. You are similar to the American teenager. Snapchat?
Mm-hmm.
No TV.
A little Facebook, but, you know, not if your mom's there.
Mm-hmm.
And,
true.
Now, Patrick has suggested a new game called Train Combat Simulator.
Yes. Absolutely.
You've got a split second to shoot that guy as you go by. I don't know what you would do.
Yes.
Yeah.
That is for sure.
Yeah.
A dumb way to die.
And Dean says, you know, trains are more difficult than they look, what with the weight and such.
I agree with Dean. You think it's easy to drive a train?
I don't know.
No, it's not.
It seems like, it would be fairly easy. But you got to pay attention.
Because
you come to the end of the track, you got to really stop.
Mm-hmm.
It's really important.
You know what else isn't easy?
I'm guessing an advertiser.
Getting a mortgage
loan. Getting a mortgage. Oh, with Rocket Mortgage, it's super easy. Oh, I love Rocket Mortgages. So this comes from Quicken Loans, the number one mortgage lender in the country. All right. If it's time to buy or time to refi, you're going to want to check this out. QuickenLoans.com/iOS today. Now, not only is Quicken Loans the best, and I mean, I'm not just making that up. They've got the number one J.D. Power Customer Satisfaction Award in mortgage origination and mortgage servicing for years. So they're literally the best. They've also got a little soft spot for the geeks. They're very techno savvy. And they've created a product just for people like you who watch this show, who would like to apply for a loan from your iPad or your iPhone or your Android device or your computer. Not put on pants and go down to the mortgage office and say, I want to get a loan and bring all your paperwork. No, you can do it all online. Even submit the pay stubs and the bank statements all with a touch of a finger. It's Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. It's fast. It's powerful. They call it Rocket Mortgage because it lifts the burden of applying for a home loan. So skip the bank. Skip the waiting. Get approved in minutes, not days or months or weeks, at Rocket Mortgage. QuickenLoans.com/iOS today. Equal housing lender. Licensed in all 50 states and MLSConsumerAccess.org, number 3030. All you got to do is go to QuickenLoans.com/iOS today. I know you're probably, you're watching the show. You're not buying a house right now. You're not refinancing right now, but when the time comes, remember that quickenloans.com/iOS today.
Or if someone else is, you might
tell them.
Recommend it
tell
to them.
Yeah.
All right. Are you wearing your Apple Watch?
Is that
you
an Apple
are.
Watch? I am.
You
yes.
are wearing your Apple Watch. So it's been a long time since we talked about Apple Watch bands.
Here is it time for a new Apple Watch band?
I think it's time. I know how much you love the cuffs. the Apple Watch cuffs.
Oh, look. Oh, this is so manly.
These are from Black Forest Atelier. Is that how you pronounce it?
Atelier.
Atelier. Is that a leather?
It means workshop.
Oh,
in French.
Workshop.
So these are really beautiful.
They are.
I have to commend Apple because they could have, as you know, almost you'd expect Apple to make the attachment proprietary.
They did not.
But they did not. It's not the standard that other watch bands use, but it is something that any manufacturer like Black Forest can adopt. So let me try it. I can put it on.
Okay, so while you're putting that on, I'll show you this green one.
Ooh,
from Black Forest.
Pretty.
I like the color, and I like the leather and the feel. I just put it on today, so it needs a little bit of breaking in, as all good leather does. But what do you think of the green?
That's pretty. Actually, yeah. I really like that.
The green against the pink.
And the thing is, since watch bands are so easy to change, I think with this watch, more than any other watch, you're very likely to want to have multiple bands for different occasions. Mm-hmm. So this is kind of my, my dressier band. It's the leather, soft leather band from Apple. All Apple watches have a little button on the bottom. You can barely see it. And then press it and it slides out. Now, I'm going to give you a little tip.
Okay.
A little tip. So I always put it on wrong. Mm. The short part should be near the knob, right?
The short part near
short
the knob.
Part near the knob. And this one, it's not hard to figure out side to put on. But sometimes on a band, you can't tell. And Apple and most other bands, you can tell because there'll be a little printing on the underside. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you don't want that in the top. So you take the short part, and I'll take it here, the short part, and you put it on the top by the button on the underside. And I guess because of the way this is, I'm going to have to do it with this faced up. And then it's very easy. These click in, and I've never had a band come off by accident. Have you?
I haven't. You know what happens by accident, though, is sometimes you accidentally press the password.
Well,
And then it says, oh, try again in five
minutes.
Yeah,
I have to wait 5 minutes before I can use my Apple
Watch.
That's
my only issue.
You should probably unlock. Well, no, you can't, because as soon as you take it off your wrist, it's going to be locked again. So there's nothing really you can do about that.
I like that one on you, Leo.
It's very manly.
The black might match
you.
Yeah.
I look like Paul Hogan. I should really.
Yes.
Yes.
You're ready for the Australian Outback.
I am going to keep that on for a little later when I wear my Paul Hogan hat. That is nice. I like that.
Yeah. So they're not cheap, but they're well made, and they're not as expensive as
How
Apple
much?
Bands. That's a great question. I know Brian has the website up
black
there.
BlackForest-Atelier, ATELIER.com. Oh, I like some of those.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm going to check this out.
Black Forest.
So they probably have varying prices.
They do, yeah. And definitely less expensive than the Apple Watches you can get from
Apple. This is
nice.
Yeah, I think it's nice to have different looks for your Apple Watch.
Crocodile skin.
Oh, I should have gotten
ostrich
that
skin.
For my Bob Hogan, Paul Hogan look.
Mermaid skin.
Mermaid skin.
Yeah, you've never had anything
mermaid.
Made out
Wait
of
minute,
mermaid
Wait a minute,
there's
another
skin.
One in here.
Yeah.
Oh, there's two.
There's two in each one, yeah.
Oh, and this is just a regular leather. Actually, that's
nice.
Yeah.
Well, what about the black? Do you have a black band?
I don't, because I have the white Apple Watch. I should probably trade you.
Yeah.
Do you like brown better than black?
I like brown better.
I don't like
than
the
black.
Kitty cat stitching on that.
You
so,
don't?
No,
I
you
like the
that.
Stitching. Kitty Looks, cat is that?
Doesn't it feel like kitty cat?
No.
No, that's my
do you,
name.
Do you
for
think
it.
Kitty cat on? The
yeah,
green
yours
one?
Looks like a kitty cat too.
No. Huh.
I don't know where that came from, but
like
anyway,
the kitty cat ears?
These are nice. Hmm. Do we have to send it back or can I wear this?
You can wear it.
Okay. So now I can't take it off though because I have to get underneath to take it
okay.
off.
Okay.
All right.
Well, when you work on that, let's do some news. Have you heard Apple might be having some trouble with the fingerprint sensor on the new iPhone?
I have not heard.
That's what some analysts are saying, and they might ship the iPhone 8 without a fingerprint sensor. Do you believe that?
Lord.
That's the news of the day.
That's not going to fly. I don't buy that for a minute.
So they were trying to put the fingerprint sensor, like right now the fingerprint sensor is not part of, it's not part of the phone itself, not part of the glass, right? The glass front. But
yeah,
because
it's going to
be bezel-less, the idea is it's going to be bezel-less.
Oh, they're having trouble with their glass fingerprint.
Under the glass fingerprint.
Oh, interesting.
So they might do, facial 3D sensing, which is facial recognition.
So I'm getting the Samsung Galaxy S8 later this week, and that does the same thing. They made the bezels are much smaller, the frame is much smaller, so they have to put the fingerprint thing under the...
the OLED screen?
Under the OLED screen. Actually, they put the... No, see, they didn't do what Apple is rumored to be doing. They put a real fingerprint reader on the back of the phone, just like a lot of other folks
right,
do.
The back.
So Apple's not doing that, apparently. They're doing it so that it would read it through the screen.
Yeah.
I could see that maybe they would be having trouble with that. But again, that's a rumor. Mm-hmm. Another story that's interesting, related story, is there's been a lot of security researchers trying to assess how secure a fingerprint is. It turns out it's a little bit less secure than people thought. The way that the iPhone and other fingerprint readers work, they snap a picture of your fingerprint, but not of the whole thing, a small thing. They keep track of a small number of features. And these professors were able to demonstrate that there is more commonality. Everybody agrees that a fingerprint is unique, or mostly unique, very unlikely to be identical between any two people. But there is more commonality if you don't do the whole fingerprint, just a few features. And they estimate that you could get a master lock and make a master lock fingerprint that would work one time out of 10. And the way they did this is they used the fingerprint pictures that are generated by, I'm not sure if they used the iPhone, I bet they didn't, but by some similar device, and they matched those to actual fingerprints, and they found there were false positives in a fair 10% of the cases. Mm-hmm. So what they hypothesize is a bad guy could make a special glove. Each finger has a different fingerprint on it. With one of them, any one of them has 1 in 10, but let's get the STEM students to do the calculations. If there's 5 and each one has a 1 in 10, what is the chances that you'll be able to unlock any given iPhone? It's about 50%, right? Yeah. And if you had 10, you'd be pretty good.
Yeah.
So you'd be able to unlock almost every iPhone you come across. So there is some suspicion that maybe the fingerprint reading technology is not as secure. It's not been weaponized yet. Bad guys haven't used it. And it's important to note that the researchers didn't try it on actual phones. The way they did is compared fingerprints to these samples to see how many false positives there were. So it's very interesting. Mm. Now, they, you say, are suggesting maybe face recognition. And it's important. You said an important thing, 3D.
Right. So a picture can't fool it, right?
Right. So we know that the Samsung Galaxy S8, which just uses 2D, two dimensionals, can be fooled by a picture. So you could show it a picture of yourself and the phone unlocks. That's not so good because almost anybody could get a picture of somebody, right? 3D, which is what Microsoft uses on the Hello sensor on Microsoft Windows, also senses depth. So normally the way face recognition works is it measures things like, you know, face geometry, things like the distance between your eyes, the length of your nose, how far from the tip of your nose to your beautiful bow-like mouth, and or not. So if you do 2D, then you can have more measurements, and it can't be fooled by a flat picture, things like how deep are your eye sockets or how far back are your ears from the front of your head, things like that. So that is a much more effective way, and I believe, I don't know if researchers have attacked this, but Microsoft says, this is pretty effective. The best, though, and this is what Samsung, anyway, suggests, either fingerprint or iris scans. And iris scans that Samsung uses on its phones are apparently very, very reliable, very secure.
So the facial recognition on the Samsung phone is really just for convenience, right?
They say that. Yeah. They say don't. And now that we know it's easily spoofed, you wouldn't want to use that.
I don't think Apple would bring a phone to market that doesn't have 3D, Touch ID.
It's a rumor. Mm-hmm. If it's true, this is extremely bad news for Apple.
Well, it's a rumor that came through an investment letter. Like, it was in, that's how this market moves.
Early days yet. I mean, so let's say they ship this phone in September or offer it in September, ship it in late September, early October. They would probably need to get to manufacture with the final version in 3 months. Maybe June or July. You don't want to go too much later than that because you can't make enough phones to feed the supply. Mm-hmm. It may be that what will happen is they can't figure it out till September or August, in which case, and this has happened, remember it happened with the AirPods. I think this is the kind of thing that might have happened with the AirPods, which is, we got a problem. And then they delay it and it's in very short supply initially. You know, if they start making them in August, you might have a million.
Mm-hmm.
But so a million people could get it. That could be very bad news. There's a lot of pressure, I think, on Apple for this 10th anniversary iPhone. A lot of people looking and saying, this has got to be something special.
I've made up a rumor also about the new phone. I think it's going to be called the Apple phone instead of the iPhone. What do you think about that? Because, they just got rid of iTunes being called iTunes.
What do they call it? Tunes?
Apple Music.
Apple Music.
Well, Apple Music, and then iTunes is called... podcasts. You don't get podcasts from iTunes anymore. iTunes still exists for now, but you don't get podcasts from iTunes. You get them from Apple Podcasts.
Somebody was asking me, well, I want to get the new iPad. What do I call it? iPad. Yeah. It's not iPad Air. It's not iPad Pro. It's not iPad... It's just iPad.
They're just going to call
they
that
like
Pad.
This. Pad. They just like the generic stuff. And I wouldn't be surprised if they wanted to get rid of the I designation.
Because it's very... It's old fashioned. Yeah, it's very early 2000s.
And really, the Apple phone, I kind of... There's a certain ring to that, right? That's all you need to say.
You can credit me. Start that
rumor.
It's
a good rumor.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it's probably just as reliable as any other rumor at
this
point.
Exactly. All right. Well, Coachella was this weekend.
What? I missed it?
I guess you missed it.
I miss it every year.
All the cool kids were there. We had a great time. And when I say we, I do not mean me because I was not there. But there were a lot of people with iPhones there. And many of them got their iPhones stolen by one guy.
What?
One guy.
Just went around taking iPhones?
And so a group of Coachellas.
Coachellians,
they used Find My iPhone and followed this guy around, like a group of them.
Oh my God!
Found the guy. He had stolen over 100 phones,
what?
Not necessarily iPhones.
And they just a crowd of 100 angry people surrounded him.
You never want to run into a crowd of angry Coachellians.
Where did he put 100 phones?
This is a really good question. I do not. He probably like taped them to his legs, like you've seen those guys when
he
they're
trying like
to smuggle
them. He looked like the Michelin Man. No wonder they found him. Mm-hmm, they didn't even find my iPhone.
And some people never even claimed their phones. They're still in the lost and found. So, all right, here's an Australian story, just for our Australian friends. In some places, maybe, I don't know if it's Perth, maybe just Melbourne, they're putting in-ground traffic lights to save us iPhone addicts from getting run over.
You know why? We're looking at our phone. We're not looking out in the front. So they put the light on the floor, on the ground,
yes,
so we'll see it.
Just Sydney and Melbourne. I guess people in Perth are smarter than that to walk across
dumb
the street, right?
Ways to die.
Yeah. So they're built into the ground. And, yeah.
I've seen people, you've seen, everybody's seen people walk into the street. Looking at their phone, not looking at anything.
Mm-hmm.
Just what are they thinking?
Mm-hmm.
They're busy playing Dumb Ways to Die.
Exactly.
Wouldn't that be kind of ironic if you got killed playing Dumb Ways to Die?
Yes, yeah. But you won't in Melbourne.
Not in Melbourne.
Because you can see the big light shining up at you. All right, did you hear that the accelerometer could be used to hack into your phone to determine your PIN? There was some research that...
How would that be?
Because this was according to research.
So when you're typing on your PIN,
so it knows where you are moving and can feel where the where your numbers go in. So this was from Science Friday. If I'm a fan of Science Friday, and they interviewed somebody who said mostly Android phones, but also iPhones. You can also get your iPhone. They said it was over 70% accurate the first time.
What?
And, yeah.
Oh, man. There's no hope.
The thing about the accelerometer is...
Well, how would they read the accelerometer?
I don't know.
Yeah.
Do you know that story, Brian? It's up there somewhere.
You'd have to hack in your phone first and have some software running on there.
Okay, so I guess would you have to hack into your phone?
Well, see, actual risk versus user perception. That's the key there. There's not really an actual
Well,
risk.
I guess because you'd have to. It's like the Samsung smartphones,
right.
Smart TVs spying on you.
Right.
But they make a good point, though, because your location, you have to give permission to your camera. You have to give permission to your microphone, but you don't have to give permission to your accelerometer. That's not one of the permissions. It could be a way. I think it's more easily on Android.
Why do you think that Apple doesn't ask? Probably because they don't know how to explain what you're giving permission. Would you like this app to have permission to know how your phone is going through space?
Right, because it's not your location. It's this.
I bet you that's why they don't ask.
Because I don't know exactly how that works. I mean, you'd have to do it at the exact right direction. I don't know.
They'd
Somebody's
say,
a
you
hacker.
Know, if it,
tell me how to do
if,
this.
If you tapped the upper right-hand number on the pad, the phone would go that way.
Uh-huh.
Upper left-hand would go... It'd be very slight differences, but the accelerometer is pretty accurate.
Well, if someone ever does it, you know, you can't say we didn't warn you.
Right.
We did.
Right.
Ready for an email?
Yes.
Johnny writes, I'm attempting to get all my files, photos, videos, etc. onto iCloud so I can ditch the laptop and go 100% iPad.
Oh, Apple loves you.
First, I know iCloud is not a backup solution, especially in the case of going 100% iPad. What service do you recommend backing up iCloud photos and videos?
Why isn't iCloud a backup solution?
I don't know. Because if you delete one of your photos on your phone, it's going to delete everywhere, right? It's not backing up.
It warns you before it does that.
Right, but like Google Photos, if I delete one of my photos in Apple Photos, it's gonna stay on Google Photos. So I think that's what he means.
Well, that would be a good choice, right?
Google Photos, which I believe has unlimited free storage if you accept Google compressing your files. I'm also looking at the 1 terabyte uncompressed free storage with Flickr.
Don't forget, if you're an Amazon Prime member, unlimited Amazon storage for Amazon Prime members.
Is there an easy way to get your photos to Amazon Prime?
Yeah, you put the Amazon app on.
But you have to do it manually, or can it automatic?
No. I think it's automatic, yeah.
You can also do OneDrive, too, even on an iPhone.
Microsoft solution. Mm-hmm.
Microsoft OneDrive.
Right, and once you start going there, there's Dropbox. Also, will automatically copy pictures to your Dropbox folder.
But they don't give you much free. Or maybe it's just like we've all been using Dropbox for so long.
They give you 5 gigs free, that's all. Box. A lot of these. Box, with the Box app, it doesn't have a switch that says copy your photos, but actually maybe even more useful, you can copy individual files, folders. So I just said, well, keep my DCIM folder, that's where the pictures are stored, keep that backed up to box.com. So you could, maybe it's even better, because it's more like a traditional backup solution, but it's not free either. So his big issue is, if I delete a photo, it's deleting the app, and he doesn't want that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I don't think any of the solutions we've mentioned will delete the photo on the cloud if you delete it locally. But if you use iCloud's photo library, right, you can have it only store the originals in the cloud and store thumbnails, small screen size appropriate versions of the photo on your phone. That saves you a lot of space.
But is there a way?
And that doesn't delete.
I guess you're right.
Yeah.
So if you wanted to delete, like I think
that
actually.
That keeps the originals on iCloud no matter what.
Right. iCloud is a bit confusing, wouldn't you say?
I'm one of the most confused. Mm. Yeah. I'm always trying to figure out. That's where iMore is so good. A little free plug for our friend Renee Ritchie and Serenity Caldwell, because they do all those tutorials. And there is an excellent iCloud tutorial on iMore.com.
I also have a question from me.
Okay.
As you know, I have signed up for the first month free of YouTube TV.
Yay!
And I wanted to stream it to my Android TV.
Yay!
A Sony Bravia Android TV. It works sometimes, and then sometimes it doesn't.
Yeah. That's why I'm giving you a better network.
Okay. So, yeah, that's what, because it sometimes it just says that. It just says cast to.
Yeah. Connecting. I've had that problem. Actually, it's not unusual with Chromecast and casting.
So it's my
Wi-Fi.
I
have the same problem with AirPlay, by the way. From time to time, I'll say, I'll be sitting here. I'll say, oh, everybody, let's watch this video. And sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. I think that's got to be network specific, I would think. We're trying different mesh routers. I'm giving Megan for her new home a housewarming gift, only slightly used Orbi router. So we can see how that works for you. That might improve it, actually.
It doesn't get used up, right? Like, it doesn't matter that it's
slightly
used.
It's only slightly worn. Some of the bits are worn.
Well, I always appreciate when you give me your hand-me-down technology. But there's a very, and don't get me wrong, there's a very small part of me that thinks, well, he got something better. I want something better.
Yes, because you got the thing I didn't want.
Right, exactly. Yeah. But I really appreciate it. And I'm
You're
excited about the
my reason. Apple Watch.
So,
so what do you think? Black?
Black.
With white or brown with white? I think for what I'm
what
wearing,
do you
I'm
think?
Wearing a black.
Style conscious Australians.
Brown.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hmm. There you go.
You know, we haven't talked about YouTube TV. Do we want to talk about that? You talked about it on the screensavers, and you talked about it on
Jason
the
did
Google.
A good review, I think, for Android users on our screensaver show and all about Android. But we haven't played with it on the iPad. So let's show it off, because
well,
I'm really
it is.
Fond of it.
So, again.
But this is weird, and this bothers me. It's in portrait mode until you play a video.
Right. So if I wanted to see Middlesbrough versus Arsenal, I can play it.
Now we're going to lose.
Then,
we're going to lose these guys. They're going to be watching soccer. No, you like Aussie rules football, right?
Yeah. So and
Much,
then,
do you have any footy on there?
Do I? This is this is footy. Isn't this the footy?
No.
Oh, sorry. Football is footy.
Footy is the greatest sport known to.
Oh, person. Footy is a different thing.
Footy is amazing.
Okay. All right. So you can watch live TV. You can watch ABC.
Australians are lucky. They have many kinds of football.
I don't know why the People's Court always shows up for me.
Because they know you like it.
Okay.
It's funny. I have Arsenal as well. I have the same soccer game.
So, yeah, it's pretty great. but I don't think it's going to be worth it for me. I'm probably not going to subscribe.
You're a cord cutter, so you're the natural audience. So here's a couple of things as we have been using it, people have complained about. One, it does have this great DVR function. So if you see a show, I can go back to my home, and let's say I go, oh, I've got, you know, I keep missing Saturday Night Live because it's so late for me. You can easily record it, right? Because it has an unlimited DVR. But what people are a little upset about, and I'm not sure it's fair, is that the shows that you have recorded have the ads in them, and there's no skipping. Now,
that was funny.
It's true. You can skip the ads on, you know, your TiVo by fast forwarding, and in fact TiVo has a 30-second skip, which makes it very easy to skip ads. But I'm not surprised that Google, I mean, this is the DVR of the whole show, including all the ads in the show, and I'm not really surprised that Google's deal that they made with the locals. This is a good episode.
It is a good episode.
I love this episode. We're watching Parks and Rec Season 2, Episode 9. If you haven't seen it, it's just hysterical. In any event, shoot, now I'm going to be distracted.
No.
But notice, this is really a recording. See, it's got the FX bug in it. And this is a recording from the local station. It's going to have the local ads and everything. It doesn't surprise me that it's there. I do admit that, you know, many DVRs, if you have a home DVR, have commercial skip. But I don't think that that's a deal breaker. It is probably something people should be aware of, is that you can't skip the commercials. But $35 a month, you get a pretty good selection of channels. It's only in 5 cities right now. That's because of the deal with the live locals. I should stop this before we get dinged for copyright violation. But I don't know. I'm still kind of a fan. And the thing I really think is going to be is killer about this is if you keep scrolling down for the YouTube generation, let me get out of this. If you keep scrolling down, they've got YouTube videos here too. And so it's mixed YouTube videos in with regular television. And I think for a generation, you know, the people under 25, that's a very natural, normal way to think of programming. They don't think of it as, oh, I've got to get Channel 5 or I've got to get NBC. They think of it all as just content. And it's good for YouTube, certainly, because you see the YouTube stuff. But I think for somebody who grew up on YouTube, this is the right way to do it. So
yeah.
I'm kind of a fan. And I do think, if nothing else, I hope that the cable companies, the DVR manufacturers, take note of the user interface. I just think it's a spectacular user interface. This is the live TV interface. It's a little different on a computer than it is on the iPad. But I just think this is so much better than anything else I've used. It should... look, we can watch dental work. it should... I really think this should be... I love the way that as you're scrolling through the program guide, you see the live... What's playing right now live... So you can make that choice reasonably.
So it's designed for your iPad, your iPhone. It's not designed for the TV. There's no Apple TV app. But
there's the Chromecast button.
Yeah.
And so I think the way to think of this is $35 for a Chromecast, or if you buy 2 months subscription of YouTube TV, you get a free Chromecast. Think of this as a really nice remote control. And when you want to watch it, you just cast it to your Chromecast and you watch it on your big screen TV. But you still have this kind of really slick user interface, particularly on the iPad. I mean, it uses that space so well. I just really like it. So that's YouTube TV. It's tv.youtube.com, and they have a free 1 month trial if you're in the right markets. And again, it's very limited right now because they haven't made the deals. Is it time for hats?
It's time for Australian hats.
This is the closest.
Is my hat Australian? Sort of. Okay.
It's Australian. If you went to a Mexican restaurant in Australia, they'd probably be wearing that.
Also, I could
Mine's
stack
Australian.
Tim Tams on here, like all around, and
that would make it Australian. I think we have some Tim Tams in the other room. If you want to go off, you can't get Tim Tams here. Is this flip on the right or the wrong side, or should I have them both like that? No, if they said that's not a real. That's a cowboy hat. Maybe they could tell because I have gaffer's tape holding it up. That's the giveaway.
Possible.
That's what makes it not really an Australian hat. Is there a name for this kind? Is it like an Outback hat or something like that? It's a military hat. So if I salute like that, it's... Yeah. Yeah. All right.
Why are we wearing hats?
Probably to curry favor with our Australian fans.
Mm-hmm.
And to honor the best apps of the week.
Mm-hmm. Our app caps, as you will. I'm not going to be able to show you much of my app because then I would have to show you all my personal financial information.
Ooh, it's that kind of app.
Yes. This is called Digit. Have you heard of Digit?
No.
Okay. Well,
I've used Mint, Personal Capital. Is this like those?
It is, but it's better. It's for the young people, the millennials.
It's for the young.
Yeah. So here is what it looks like on the. It's an iPhone app, but here is what it looks like.
Oh, I think you know who uses this. My daughter, Abby.
Really?
Think,
yeah. Well, that doesn't surprise me. Yeah. So you can sign up for free. You create an account, which I will not do. So I know. I think there's a video that Brian you can show.
Show the video because her hat's in the way. Anyway.
Right. And my hat's in the way. Okay. So I use Mint. Mint's fine, but what Digit does is it actually. It texts you.
So uses your messaging.
You sign up. You give them your bank account number. It's FDIC protected. Is that what you call it? FDIC approved.
Insured
up to $250,000. So, And what it does is it uses algorithms to look at your bills and when they're due and decide when you could save a little bit of cash.
Oh, I like that. What do you mean, like by not paying your bills?
It sees what extra cash you have.
Right.
So, like, if I don't have any bills.
This would be very helpful. So you get a paycheck. You know how it is.
Mm-hmm.
You run out of money at the end of the month. You've paid all the bills. But there are times when if it could just take a little bit out, you could build your savings and still pay all your bills.
Right. And at the beginning of the show, I said, I'm done with money. And yes, like, you could just take a little bit of your paycheck and have it automatically put into a savings account. But that's not using algorithms.
And some banks, Bank of America, for instance, has a save the change a thing where they'll round up charges and checks and they'll save the difference into a savings account.
So there are a fair amount of apps like this. So what it does is it texts me. It sends me a text message every day with my balance, which is really helpful to
me.
Because if I'm like going to buy a bunch of furniture and I have an idea of how much money I have to spend, or if I'm going to buy coffee, anything like that, it'll tell me. And then I can also just text it. It's like a bot. I can text it a little umbrella emoji and then it will tell me how much money I've saved for a rainy day. So I really like this app. You can show the Apple Watch app because that doesn't have any of my. I'll show.
Oh, I like it that it has an Apple Watch.
So it has an Apple Watch. Can you see that? Okay, so there's the Digit app, and then I can say what my savings is, and it will tell me. So far, for a rainy day, I've saved $14.95 and $37.67 for a trip to Australia, which I didn't.
Good news.
You can't really. Yeah,
you're really close.
And so all I have to do.
You go by tramp freighter.
I just reply with that little airline. I couldn't find the Australian. What's the Australian emoji? I just used an plane.
Sure you get the flag.
Oh, the flag. Yeah. So it just figures it out and takes it. Okay, here's why I said there was a lot of apps like this, why I chose this one. It used to be free, and now they're charging $3 a month.
Ooh, that's not good.
No, to charge money to save money, except... You know why they're doing it?
Why?
They're doing it because they're not taking your they're not selling your information.
Oh,
they're not putting ads on the app.
I
they're not
like that.
They're not trying like Mint
so they
is
need
always,
to monetize.
Yeah, Mint is always trying to sell you this credit card or this life insurance or
Put it a little bit differently, but that's you're right.
Exactly.
That's exactly what's
happening. Well, people are upset because people have been using this app for a long time and they think, nobody wants to pay for something that's been free. But the creator of the app was very transparent and just said, when he said we're not selling your information, everyone thought, I thought you were selling my information.
Right.
Everyone just automatically assumes. And so
best solution is to offer a free version that we do sell your information and a paid version and let people choose because you're going to pay one way or the other. So, the guy needs to make money on his app. So I think that's good, though.
That.
I like the choice.
I like it, too. I mean, there's other apps. There's something called Tip Yourself, which is similar. You can, it takes more user interaction. There's no interaction with me. It's just the algorithm saying, I don't know. Like, yesterday it was $6.50. Today it's $14. I don't know. I don't care. But I'm putting money away, and I'm not putting it away right before I have a big bill due or something like that. And they will pay your overdraft charges if it makes a mistake, and they've taken that money out of your bank account. And you have no money, they'll pay for your overdraft. That's how confident they are
in
their
algorithm. As they should, by the way.
And they will also pay they'll pay interest to a certain amount. It's not that much. Like if you have like $4,500 in the account or something, you would get $10 a year. It's not, so you get it back. Well, I guess $10 wouldn't get it back. But you'd have to have a certain amount of money in there.
Yeah.
So Digit, I like it, and I like the way they've decided to monetize and be transparent about that, as opposed to some of the other financial apps.
And something the chat room is pointing out, and this is true, that many banks do offer a similar service, and you should check your banking app to see, and it might do something kind of similar. Digit seems like it's a little more sophisticated than the stuff I've seen from other banks.
And it's fun. Like, who doesn't want to text an emoji of an umbrella to see how much money they have saved for a rainy day? If you could do, like, if you want to, they're called goal emojis, which is fun to say.
Goal emoji.
So if you want to save for a car, you make a car emoji.
I like
that. If you want to save for an eggplant, you do the eggplant emoji or something like that.
One of these days, I got to save some money. So I asked our illustrious studio audience, again from the fabulous St. Norbert's School in Perth, Australia. They came a long way. To visit us. For a good app for my app cap. And I've got one. Thanks to, I forgot your, Ayushi. She says she loves Cooking Fever. And you know what? I started playing it and I kind of like it too.
I have Cooking Fever.
So this is a free, but there's in-app purchase. Have you spent any money on this, Ayushi, or... No. So you can play it free. I like that in a freemium game. You know, they want you to buy, coins or whatever. So I've completed an achievement. Wait a minute. While I've been sitting here, let's claim my experience points and my coins. I'm at the very beginning of this. So we'll just play it. This is, Ayushi looks at this and goes, oh, you're such a beginner. But I'm getting better. Okay, so here we are in our cafe. I'm looking to make 90 chicken coins, and I'm behind the bar. Somebody comes in, and he wants a burger. I think I know how to make a burger, right? Customer wants a cola. Wait, a cola? I know how to make a burger. Let's start with the burger, and let's get the burger frying, and then take the glass and drag it to the customer. Oh, good. Funny hat or not, I still get the coins. Now, we have to wait till the burger is cooked, obviously. So I'm waiting. Meanwhile, somebody with bunny ears comes in and wants another burger. Let's put up. Oh, boy. Okay. Oh, okay. Let's and then put that burgers up. Okay. And then I'm going to put and then I got some coins and then I'm going to make some more meat. Okay. I got the bun. I can only do one bun at a time. I guess if I got some more coins, I could unlock more bun positions. Wait a minute. He wants. Oh. Okay. Here's a cola. Is that burning? Okay. Let's put some more meat down. Give her. Okay. Got the coins.
Did you wash your hands?
Oh, God. I forgot to wash my hands. Hey, everybody, come back. You can't eat that. Okay, so we're waiting. So you can see how even at this very low level, this game is maybe a little bit challenging. But it's a burger and a Coke? Come on, man! Okay, so we're cooking the meat. We got the coins. Don't forget to collect your coins. And you can see it's going to get more and more complicated. She says it's a lot of fun as you get to the higher levels. She wants a Coke. Okay, there's the burger done. Let's do that. Let's serve him his burger. He's happy. Let's put a bun up here. I think I'm doing all right, right, Ayushi? This is pretty good. I'm doing great.
She wants a drink, too, the one in the green.
No, she can't have a drink.
Okay.
She wants a drink? No drinks for you. Okay. You also have to keep track of what order they come, or they're going to get unhappy, right? She wants a Coke. I have a Coke for you. And we'll do that. And we'll collect the coins there. So this looks like fun, huh? I like this kind of game where, you know, it is a little bit too much like work. But, but you know... Yay! Oh.
Yes.
Exhausting.
Good job.
Thank you. So there you go. This looks like fun, doesn't it? Cooking Fever. I'm glad she told us about it. I also wanted to mention we had a great triangulation interview last hour with a fellow who's written a book about games for change, using video games for good, and he has a game on iOS. That he created as part of his master's thesis. He studied, believe it or not, there is a degree in entertainment design at Carnegie Mellon University. He studied there. And he designed a game that I think is brilliant called Peacemaker. It's still available. I think it's $1.99. You get to play either the president of the Palestinian Federation or the Israeli prime minister. And you get to make the same kind of decisions actual politicians would have to make in this situation. Your goal is to create peace in the Middle East. Not an easy thing to do. You've got many actions, things like building settlements on the West Bank or even assassinating a leader. It's great because it gives you videos of the history interspersed. So it's an educational game, but interspersed with what is really a challenge, which is to be either the Prime Minister of Israel or the President of the Palestinian Federation and try to solve what is one of the thorniest challenges in our current political situation. There are similar games for North Korea and so forth. This is, remember this terrible explosion. So this is just giving you a little bit of a setup so you understand the real events that are inspiring this game. I think this is, I just wanted to give it a plug because it's really cool. We could play a new game. This time I should play the president of the Palestinian Federation. You get to choose if it's a calm, tense, or a violent situation. I should have picked calm because I did very poorly last time. I think that my decision to build settlements in the West Bank was not taken well. You get the idea. I mean, it's really, really fun. This is, and I think educationally, this would be a really great. Frankly, I think some of our world leaders should be forced to take this game.
Yeah.
And maybe learn a thing or two.
What if someone actually solved the peace crisis, the Middle East peace
crisis? I think you would want to take notes, write down what you did, and send it along to the parties involved. So that's called Peacemaker. So two picks. A fun one, learning how to run a fast food joint, cooking fever, and Peacemaker for the people who want to solve, you know, create world peace. Kind of is a kind of cooking, isn't it? Yeah.
There's some fire coming your way.
Oh, hey, you know, I forgot to mention this. You know what today is?
What?
Today
my
is
birthday?
The 12th anniversary of the very first episode of This Week in Tech. It was April, what is it today, the 12th?
Today's the
17th. April 17th, 2005, we did the very first episode of TWIT. And so we thought we'd have a cake. Because we have students, I think we'll have somebody we can eat this cake. So where's Lisa? Can you get Lisa? Because she said, I don't want anybody eating cake without me. Our CEO who runs the business, and we wouldn't have been around for 12 years without Lisa Laporte.
So it's our 12th
birthday.
It's coincidental,
isn't it? She has the same name as me. Isn't that kind of interesting? Don't know how that happened.
So it's our 12th birthday.
12th anniversary of Twitch.
We're becoming an adult. Maybe we need to shave. We like to play a little.
You know, you've been with us for longer than any other host, I think. There was a gap in between. But when did you start doing Jumping Monkeys?
2008.
So very early on, Megan was doing a show with us. Come on in, Lisa. Our CEO, Lisa Laporte. Again, total coincidence she has the same name. And thank you for the cake.
I think you'd ask that, though.
You do. Why is your name the same as Leo's? She's my sister, everybody. No. Anyway, happy anniversary. Thank you, Lisa, for helping us keep this ship afloat. Should we blow out the candles?
Yeah, before it burns cake.
You and me together. Ready? Did they do that? I hate that. There's a couple of laggards.
See, that's why she's the CEO. She comes up with the solutions.
We should have had Bunning snacks for everybody, but we got cakes instead.
That was
a good one. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time on iOS Today. See you.